on that particular bridge where the fire was, there's rail cars hauling molten steel from the J&L plant over to the rolling mill, and they all start sparking 90 oil and the debris at the base of the bridge.
The noise was deafening, the air was choking, and the river, just depending on what day you were there, there was oil, there was pickle liquor, it was flowing orange, red, and just all, it was almost an alien environment.
It had its own unique smell, and a big cleanup tool for an oil spill was a squeegee, shove it all off into the river. But remember, all of this was before the Federal Water Pollution Control Act of 1970 and 1972. So all of that was quite legal, what was being done to make a mess in the river.
Time magazine captured an image, and that really led people to say, no more, we need to do something about this. So it was just getting enough political will to address this and really start with the industries that had turned their back on the river.
That was pretty shocking. Like I said, I was hired by the agency to clean this river up, and I remember having some thoughts about it. It might be hopeless, you know. There were days where I really wondered whether we were going to be able to make any progress at all down in an area like that.
There was a group put together called the Oil Study Group, and it was made up of all the people that handle oil on the river. Everybody became, let's say, good corporate citizens and did their part to try and study this thing and see how we could clean it up.
When we first sat down, some of the very first RAP meetings that we had, it stands for Remedial Action Plan, and this came out of the International Joint Commission, which was a commission set up between the United States and Canada, initially to deal with border disputes, but water quality became such an issue in the late 60s and early 70s, they took on the role of water quality. We had members from the Sierra Club, we had LTV Steel, and we had Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District. I mean, there were a lot of different perspectives on what they wanted and what they felt was needed for the river. People had their shields up and people were guarded during the first few meetings, but as they went on, I noticed people started, you know, a lot went on getting coffee in between the breaks and people talking on the side, and hey, this guy's not so bad, he's not really the enemy. Getting one another to listen to one another and better understand that, that's a real important part of that process.
We had a Clean Water Act, the first version of the Clean Water Act. An EPA was formed both nationally at the state level. Coincidentally, the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District, then the Cleveland Regional Sewer District, was formed to tackle broad issues. When rivers are burning, things are bad.
There wasn't an understanding of what we could do to make it better. We did not have any of the technologies that we had now. And that's one of the important things about the cleanup of the river, is that we had to develop an education system where we actually trained technicians on what to do. We had to do research in terms of what to find out, what could be done. And these processes got better over time. So we had to invent a whole new set of clean water infrastructure in order to clean up the river.
A lot of the improvement, I think, can be attributed to a few things. Obviously, a lot of investment by the sewer district, $5 billion, more than $5 billion, since we were formed. Other investments by other communities, City of Akron and surrounding communities, but there's been investment, environmental investment, to help clean up things and make things better in terms of water quality. Industrial discharges became regulated under the Clean Water Act. We play a role, we are kind of the EPA for the what we call a pre-treatment program. Industries need to clean up their waste streams before they discharge to us, and that's really helped as well. So there's been sustained investment over time
I think so often in the environmental community, you know, it's kind of a bummer, right? So folks see mistakes and we talk about climate change and people feel like there's a lack of progress. But when you come to Cleveland and you go to the Cuyahoga River and you walk along the east banks of the flats, you can see it, you can smell it, and it's a huge improvement.
But you're not gonna see stuff like the flats on a river that's full of oil. So that really stimulated some of the economic things. And there's another uptick going on right now. And I think that's great. The Metro Parks has taken control of certain areas. You got a restaurant on the river. The thing that amazed me about Cleveland is no restaurants on the lakefront. Why is that? Because things were bad, but we're starting to see that. We've got kayakers on the river. You know, St. Ignatius and other high school teams are sculling on the river. It's all good. There's a lot of boating interests, particularly sport fishing, you know, going on. So there's all of these are quality of life enhancements.
I think the biggest victory is that we have fish in the river and we have people utilizing the river. We have freighters going up and down. There's more and more people trying to access the river, but not just the human use, but we do have that good enough health to have teams of fish that are swimming up and down the river.
People partying at the East Bank or going to a concert in the flats. Shiny, new, colorful, fun, exciting. It's not just the bridges that have color. The valley now is colorful. And that's not something you find in a dirty old industrial valley.
It's definitely a model for environmental protection. My colleagues at Ohio Environmental Protection Agency talk about how they're visited by teams of people from all over the world because they had heard about that last burning of the river and how it started the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency and the Clean Water Act. So it's a model as far as getting those regulations and beginning to clean up the water.
As people from both sides of the river come down to know it, they start to love it. That is what we need going forward.
With regards to the future and what's coming down the pike for the Cuyahoga River, one of our kind of near-term goals is the removal of the Gorge Dam in Cuyahoga Falls. That would return the river to naturally flowing stream between Akron and the mouth at Lake Erie and here in Cleveland.
So on the Cuyahoga River, about halfway up-ish, there's a dam. It was originally built in the early 1900s as a hydro plant. So it never worked out as a functioning hydro plant, but the structure is still there. And it blocks river movement, so it disturbs the system, impounds water. Taking it out, which would be an awesome thing, requires partnerships above and beyond just Ohio EPA, and the community has to support it.
Our fish don't jump. They're not getting up past the Gorge Dam, because they don't crawl. They don't jump, they don't fly, they don't crawl. So we have to remove the barriers, and dams are barriers to fish population. That's life in a system. So restoration is life if we make it possible.
The Gorge Dam is a hunk of concrete sitting in the middle of the river, creating probably the largest unresolved water quality issue on the Cuyahoga River. There is a dam pool behind it, about a mile and a half long, and we do not meet water quality standards in that dam pool. So the opportunity here is to restore a mile and a half of water quality. This 2-mile section of the Cuyahoga River, the river falls over 200 feet. So we have this spectacularly beautiful geography, which provides an opportunity for tourism, even beyond what we experience now. It provides an opportunity for expert paddlers.
Well, what we've done in the recent past is we had two smaller dams that were removed. And what that did is that opened up about a half mile of challenging whitewater. And behind the Sheridan in our downtown, we have Class 5 rapids, but now there's a larger portion for the kayakers to enjoy. However, when those dams came down, we had to install signs with the guidance of our law department, says extreme danger, get out here. That's where those kayakers get in for their competitive races. With the Class 5 rapids, the large dam, the Edison Dam at the old power plant is still there. The kayakers tell me if that comes down, there will be 2.5 miles of challenging whitewater in Cuyahoga Falls, and there's nothing even close to that east of the Mississippi. So we'll be building more restaurants and hotels just for that reason.
What happened on the Cuyahoga River has benefited the entire world just because it put this, hey, water quality can get so bad. At that time with the news and what ended up happening was, yeah, this was the image. And we probably at some point should have been saying, hey, this isn't right. We looked at the Cuyahoga River last year as part of what we call an assessment at EPA. And most of the main flowing part of the river meet the standards we have in Ohio.
I think it shows how far we've come, and luckily so, because that could not continue the way it was. It was catastrophic to the waterway, to health, to the pollution, to dangerous situations, obviously, with a lot of the oil and things that were floating. So the fact that that's what finally it took, something catastrophic, to change our mindset, and we have. And even to today, we're still pushing forward to preserve nature as it was intended.
I embrace the burning river. I know what it meant when it burned. We have taken that burning river and turned it into a phoenix. Where we are right now is kind of a zenith. And so it's very important for us to continue these values so that the zenith continues to improve.